Ladies and gentlemen, wash out your soiled scrubs, politely decline the passionate marriage proposals, and reassure Mr. Gruff on the fifth floor that the aliens did in fact return his kidneys.
Because it's time to talk tall to me.
Jethro Tull is in the house.
I am Nick McGill.
And I am Omen Said.
We are Feckless Moans.
And this is Talk Tall to Me, an inoculation with a small part of the Jethro Tull virus directly into your bloodstream.
Every week will be a new shot in the series until you are fully, utterly immune to Jethro Tull's effects.
We take song by song, we put the music of Ian Anderson and Jethro Tull into a centrifuge, strain out its solids from its pure DNA, and then concoct that through a complex machinery of friendship and wit into a serum which, if it doesn't cure you, at least it'll make you die happy.
This week, before we get into the round of shots with the inevitable Scooby-Doo Band-Aids and lollipops, we have, I think, just one little thing to discuss, Omen, right?
That's right, Nick. Little, but important.
But important. Mary, if you don't mind.
I'm allergic to the beasts!
I know, Mary, and I appreciate that. I've provided allergy pills, and you will be getting hazard pay.
My eyelids are swollen up like the devil's own anus.
Oh, God. What has the devil been doing?
I better not to ask.
Yeah, yeah.
So, as we all know, Ian Anderson is a man of many passions. Not just prog rock music, not just salmon farming, not just restoring old cathedrals. Ian Anderson has one passion which is very close to both of our hearts, actually. Mm-hmm. He runs a cat rescue program. And we just wanted to let you know a little bit about it in Mr. Anderson's own words. So this is from the Jethro Tull Instagram page.
At Jethro Tull _.
That's right. Everyone, or at least around half of us, loves a cute and cuddly little, cat emoji, kitten. But not so many of us have the same soft spot for more mature or unwanted cats, whether strays or from unsuitable homes. Cat Chat is an online rehoming resource that assists with the placement of over 10,000 unwanted cats every year. If you think you can help, please contact them and look for your nearest homing shelter. 20 of the Cat Chat referred residents in shelters for the longest time need your help, love, and support right now at catchat.org. We, the Anderson family, have reared 25 feral cats and kittens over the years. Some went to good homes with friends and family. Some became our lifelong companions and parts of our family history. Some are still with us today. If you can commit to providing a long-term home to a shelter cat, please visit the Cat Chat website. Remember, a pussycat friend for a day is a friend for life. Ian Anderson, Jethro Tull. Yeah.
Here's your PSA for the week.
That is your PSA.
If you can afford it, if you can handle it with your life, it is a responsibility. Think about a cat.
Cat Chat.
You know? Cat Chat. Cats are pretty independent, so they're not a whole lot of work. They're not a dog or a toddler.
They're also pretty.
They're also beautiful. I love cats. I miss my cats.
Yes. Tiki, the cat which lives in my home, is a regular contributor to Talk Tall to Me. Even though you don't necessarily hear her on the podcast, she is often curled up beside me. She seems to enjoy the podcasting process.
She's very supportive.
She's very supportive. So, Nick, if that's all of the housekeeping that we have to do today, shall we jump right into our main event?
Yeah, let us. We are actually, we did a quick little revamp of the schedule just right before we started recording, and it makes the most sense for us to wrap up Living in the Past today with the last two songs as opposed to breaking it up, because From Later is a 2-minute instrumental and Nursey is a 4-line, 1.5-minute quick little pretty ditty.
That's right. So we're putting them together into a single melodious dish, and if you don't like it, you can go and suck an egg.
A lot like, well, that was drastic. It's a lot like what we did early on, and I believe, no, this was, there were a handful of instrumentals that we kind of...
That's right, we...
Combined.
Yeah, they're small, take two.
Yeah.
So Nick, without further ado, shall we listen to From Later?
Yeah, let us do that. From Later.
Goodness me, Nick, I feel like I've just had a shot of Turkish coffee.
That is the first time you've heard that, correct?
That is the first time that I've heard that track, yeah.
Okay. So, peppy, energetic, obviously.
Yeah.
Other thoughts? What comes to mind immediately after having heard that?
It's really dense. It's really, it's got a lot going on. I found that I really had to concentrate on it to kind of figure out what my ears were hearing. Not in a bad way, but there was a sense of it of like it's a step away from a cacophony.
Yeah, it's one bad instrument away from just noise.
Yeah, it is. It's like you saw a bunch of musicians and you pushed them down a staircase, but you didn't realize that they were also acrobats.
Yeah.
So now the joke's on you.
They're really good musicians, yeah.
So a couple of things stood out to me.
Sure.
And that is that, you know, in the first couple of measures, I was reminded very much of the sound that we're going to hear later on in Too Old to Rock and Roll.
In after the little opener?
Yes. No, actually, it is the opener.
Oh, okay.
There's something, maybe that's not the right album, but maybe it reminds me a little bit of Thick as a Brick, or...
See, I think it's a little more Thick as a Brick.
It definitely has that.
Or even Passion Play, maybe. Might be Passion Play.
There's something about the organ in it, which is new. We don't really have, I don't believe, a lot of organ thus far.
Yeah.
Rather than piano.
And it's very organ heavy, too. Like, that is one of the main carriers... throughout.
Yes.
And
yes.
with that opener sound, that like stepping down the scale, and then that the regular repetition and the organ, this, I don't know if you know them at all, but this feels very much like Electric Light Orchestra to me. ELO, they're often called. Hey, Omen.
Nick.
I have something really embarrassing and... I just got to clear it up right now before we get any more hate mail from our five fans.
Sure. Yeah. What is it?
This is so embarrassing. So I referred to the band who played the song Brain Salad Surgery as ELO, Electric Light Orchestra, and it's not them.
Okay.
It's not them. It's ELP. Emerson, Lake, and Palmer.
Oh, my God.
I'm so ashamed.
Nick, you're not the first person to be confused by initials.
By acronyms.
You're not the first person to be confused by acronyms.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I appreciate your supporting me in this, and I just...
Yeah.
I'll be better. I'll be better.
You know what I always say?
What's that?
Nick? As a YBF, it's my duty to A-S-U WUMAFOYS.
You don't know how much that means to me, Omen. Thank you.
NP. Not to be confused with the Trans-Siberian Snow Orchestra.
Correct.
Trans-Siberian Electric Orchestra. You know what I'm saying.
Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Yeah. No, yeah, very just... correct. It yeah, there's no snow or anything else. It's just Trans-Siberian Orchestra. They were a very prog band right okay. around this time. And they, let's see, they had Brain Salad Surgery. They had a handful of different like concept-y songs and albums.
Right.
And the songs that I know from ELO are very organ heavy.
Okay.
So this song does not feel very Tull to me at all. Even if I wasn't thinking about ELO, like it's not a terribly Tull sounding song, even with the heavy amount of flute in there.
Now, Nick, you know that I love you.
Correct.
But I must respectfully disagree.
Okay.
With your opinion, or rather, I respect your right to have that wrong opinion, and I would like to offer my opinion, which I think is more correct, which is that this does sound like a Jethro Tull song, and specifically, not just because of the flute, but also because of the rapid-fire key changes and time signature changes that just are just... leaking dangerously high levels of prog rock. I imagine that the Environmental Protection Agency is like about to shut them down for unsafe concentration of rocking out when they play this.
Well, the EPA from like 10 years ago, not present.
Oh, no, not the current EPA, certainly. Woo!
Even Martin's... That really filtered that guitar doesn't sound like Tull guitar. It doesn't sound like Martin to me.
There are a couple elements that I will agree with you that Martin doesn't sound typically Martin in the way that we're used to hearing him in this song. And yeah, there is that one moment where the I think it's the bass actually goes on a little wah pedal and we have like a little moment of disco 1970s.
Oh yeah, that's what I was talking. I think that's Martin actually.
It could be. I think it was. I thought it was the bass. So yeah, Nick. I think that. I think that might be the bass.
And yeah.
Did you say?
Yeah.
Did you? What's that sound behind it?
I think that might be the bongos or some sort of hand drum.
Some
really
kind
quick
of a hand
little.
Drum.
Yeah, with a really tight head. All of my disagreement against Tull aside, that little bit ends with Ian doing his standard woo into the
flute.
Yeah, of
course.
So, I mean, it's hard. He really makes the flute his flute. So it's hard to argue that for sure. But there are just pieces that we hear in this song that we never hear again in Tull.
That's true. But I feel like that is kind of... one of the Tull signatures is like, oh, you think you know our sound?
Sure.
We're going to do something only once and never again.
I think that is a convenient way to explain, oh, we tried this and it didn't work.
Yeah, true.
Not that it doesn't work. I mean, altogether, this is a great little song.
It seems intentional, though. I mean, like even just that wah pedal, it almost feels like, oh, yeah, everyone else is doing this. We're going to do it just to show that we can. But we hate it.
For, what, 5 seconds in a song?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it's not even a main staple in a song. It's like, hey, by the way, this, and
yeah,
we're out of here.
We can do this, but yeah. We choose not to.
But, yeah, there you go. That's what it is.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, we acknowledge everyone does this, but we're not gonna.
You and your wah pedals and your cocaine.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that might be a direct quote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cats is the only drugs you need.
Like the musical?
No. That is a drug which no one needs.
Yeah.
That is a class 5
felony possession charge.
What else do we have to say about this song, Nick?
It's nice. I like the energy. It's just shy of out of control, manic. But I do have to be in a certain mindset to listen to it. It is so intense.
It's very intense.
Yeah.
I can imagine this as a really great live song.
Oh, yeah. I could also see it as a song playing under like a car chase in a 70s or 80s action film.
Interesting. Although with that irregular beat, I feel like it would have to be sort of an art film.
Sure. With some peculiar angles and interesting cuts going right. from like the car chase to like an old lady crossing the street to someone holding up the bank to...
Right.
Yeah.
It's really a slice of life for the city through the filter of a car chase.
Yeah.
The car chase has nothing to do with the actual plot of the film.
Oh, that's cool. I like that idea. Yeah, it just so happens that it's happening because cities be crazy.
Yes. Yes, they do indeed, Nick.
What about you, Omen? Any final thoughts on From Later? What do you reckon the name is, From Later?
Wow. You've just blown my mind, Nick.
Yeah.
From Later.
From Later, maybe this is From Later down the line. This is the style that we're going to have. Is this some kind of guess at what Tull will sound like in 5 years?
Maybe. Maybe it was like a little bit of an attempt at time travel.
Yeah.
Because it's like, I don't think that there was a plan in terms of their different sounds.
Oh, I mean, aside from the next album we're going to cover, which was a very, very calculated decision.
Uh-huh.
But other than that, it feels so, such organic. An evolution. Like, yeah, an organic evolution. That's it. That's perfect.
Yeah, I don't know. From Later. I mean, I wonder if it's just a bit of a play on the words, like rather than saying from before, it's almost the other side of this was.
Yeah, it's an inconsequential title for a song of inconsequence, because it's while it's still really meaty and substantial, it's, for lack of a better term, it's kind of a throwaway.
Mm-hmm.
Just a fun instrumental.
A chance for the bassist to step forward.
For two seconds.
Although, you know, I do want to say Jeffrey Hammond has clearly really learned how to play the bass at this point.
He got thrown into it and he could sink or swim, and he has clearly stayed afloat.
He's doing the butterfly stroke at this moment.
Yeah.
He's walking that bass up and down Main Street.
He's got swimmies on his arms. I mean, it
when
it generally,
metaphors collide.
It generally helps that the band that he's playing for sang three songs about him before he joined. So it's kind of hard to fail in that environment, I think.
Right. I know. It's a delightful song. I would love to see this live. I really think that this is the sort of thing that would really pump up the crowd and get them jazzed up. And have you ever worked with groups of small children?
I used to sub, but the youngest I ever did was like fifth grade.
Oh, okay. So when you work with like really small kids, they have a lot of energy. So, you know, telling them like be quiet and sit down doesn't really work at all.
Yeah.
So you have to give them opportunities to like shake it out sometimes, to shake the sillies out. This feels like a song that functioned or that could function as an opportunity for the audience to shake out their sillies. You know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
Like, okay. after you've listened to this song, you're like, "Woo, I'm jazzed, but I'm kind of tired because I just was jamming out for 2 minutes, and now I'm ready to focus up and listen to the next song, perhaps with a refreshed concentration."
Yeah, it's a mindless refocus.
Yes.
And I'm looking on our set list site that we haven't looked at in a long time. It's not on here at all.
It's never been played live.
That's not to say it's never been played, but I mean, there are a lot of things on here, and there are songs I've never heard of.
Interesting.
So
maybe it wasn't a regular set piece for them.
I mean, we haven't seen a whole lot from Benefit or from Living in the Past, although the next one we're going to do, Nursey, I think they played fairly regularly. In fact, let me see. Nursey, 88 times. So it's not unheard of to see something from Living in the Past,
right.
But that one, when you, especially like certainly nowadays, when your catalog is so big,
right.
You don't want to kind of waste a spot and put something like from later in there, maybe, you know?
Maybe it was just an experiment.
Yeah. And they just needed to fill up the vinyl. They had four sides to do, so.
Yeah.
Or eight sides is four album. I don't.
Well, Nick, I think we can wrap up for later. From
yeah,
later.
I think so. From later.
And
although I've seen it as For Later sometimes referenced on the interwebs, but I think it's originally it is From Later.
Yeah. For Later seems like this, like when you wrap up your leftovers after you dine out.
Yeah. Yeah. When what's that for?
It's for later.
Where's
It's
like when you wake up.
Cheeseburger and fries and some cold lettuce.
Oh my goodness. Well, Nick,
I hope the lettuce is cold.
Why don't we take a quick break, and we'll be right back after these messages. Are you a cat? Are you a mature cat looking for a home? Think that no one will love you because you have only three teeth and you shed more than you sleep? Are you on your ninth life? Worried that one more fall and you might not land on your feet? Don't worry. Come down to catchat.org and find a human being gullible enough to take you into their home. Why, hello there, little fellow. What's your name?
Meow. Oh,
what a beautiful name, Rainbow. Now, can you tell me, how long have you been without a human?
Meow.
Oh my goodness, what a tragedy. Have you ever thought about going on to catchat.org? That's right, catchat.org. You can find a human in less than 30 minutes, or your money back. You don't have money, you're a cat. Catchat.
You don't have money, you're a cat. All right. Okay. Thank you from our sponsors.
Welcome.
Cat Chat. Not really sponsored. I haven't seen a check yet. I have found a dead fish on my doorstep, though. So, All right, Omen.
Hmm.
So that was a good transition into the final song that we are going to cover off of Living in the Past. What are we looking at?
Wow. We are looking at Nursey.
Nursey. Let's give us a listen to some Nursey.
Let us do give us a listen.
That was, yeah.
Thank you.
tiptoes in silence round.
Oh, Nursey.
Oh, my goodness, Nick.
That is such a pretty little song.
It's really tender.
Yeah.
What a strong comparison to For Later.
Yeah, From Later. What are the leftovers for? For Later. So this is a minute and a half. It is the fastest minute and a half of my life. Like, if this song just as sweet and slow and soft as it is, it just zips right by.
You know, it's so funny that you say that, Nick, because my experience of it was almost the opposite, that it created a huge world that seemed almost infinite or infinitely deep, perhaps.
Yeah. I think, you know what, I think some of my perception around that is because I had a Little Light Music live album, and he sings that portion. He does the full minute and a half, but then they break down into this gorgeous instrumental part, and it goes on for another, probably at least minute.
I see.
So I'm used to hearing it be longer, I think.
That makes sense.
One, two, three, two, two.
But this is, as much as I want it to be longer, I prefer this version because this is just Ian and a guitar. It's just this soft, subtle. It's just so beautiful. His acoustic work is just fantastic. So
it
good.
It really is. It really, really is. There's something really unique about it. I mean, you know, there are a lot of guitar players in the world. Perhaps
fact.
Perhaps too many.
Also fact.
But, you know, and it's easy to be like, oh, this is this kind of style. This is this kind of style. Oh, these people are mimicking this kind of thing, which comes from here. I don't know where this sound comes from. And I've never heard anyone else play the guitar like that.
I think this is kind of similar to the discussion we had a couple episodes ago. I don't remember which one it was, but it was just that we were trying to place Ian's guitar sound, his acoustic sound.
Yes.
And I think we settled on like the seed, the germination of his folk sound.
Yes.
His folk roots,
yeah,
I guess,
yeah.
Or the roots of his folk sound. I don't know. And I think that's, it fits so well. It pairs so well with what we're going to hear in a couple of years, a couple of episodes, a couple of albums, whatever. That I can see that chain of events. I can see that evolution into the sound that we're going to hear much more prevalent.
Certainly,
later on.
Yeah. Yeah, it's amazing, and it's amazing to hear it so starkly in a way where it is just him playing in the studio.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pared down.
This is the sort of thing, do you remember a couple episodes back when we were talking about, maybe it was Clive Bunker who was saying, you know, I wish that Ian did more acoustic stuff, but he has the perception that the audience just wants to see him leaping about with a flute. You know, this is the kind of thing that he was talking about. This is amazing.
Yeah, it's really good. And I think we also have the luxury of look being able to know the full catalog, being able to know where this sound goes in the future. And I think that offers a certain enhanced degree of appreciation as opposed to when this came out in 72, when you hear this for the first time.
Right.
It comes right after Aqualung.
Right.
Which also had some really decent acoustic.
Oh,
on
of
it.
Course. One of our favorites.
But then it goes into Thick as a Brick, which is the complete opposite.
Yeah.
So it's you can almost see like, oh, maybe they're going to get this sound. And for some people, maybe they didn't want to hear that acoustic, you know?
You know who, you know what, I've just placed my finger on something, Nick. And as soon as I wash my hands, I'll tell you. This reminds me, the sound reminds me actually of another guitar artist from around the same time, although they're really different.
A guitartist?
Do you know Nick Drake?
I do. Is he that old?
Nick Drake was born in...
I mean, is his music that old?
Yeah.
Was he in the 70s? Wow.
Yeah, Nick Drake died in 74. He was born in 48. So he was actually a bit older than Ian Anderson.
I was thinking of Nick Cave. Never mind.
Nick Cage?
Cave. Oh.
Do you know Nick Drake, though?
Nicolas Cage is ageless?
We don't speak of Nicolas Cage here.
Nick Drake, the name sounds familiar.
Album Pink Moon.
I think I heard one of his songs on the Garden State soundtrack, and that's it.
I think that that's the
only way I would know him.
I just want to play a little bit of it right now for you. Obviously.
It was actually on a mix CD that I had from an ex-girlfriend, so thanks for that omen. oh, God.
We'll be back right after this trip to the therapist.
Yeah, it's that level of...
Go ahead.
It is the Dylan-esque type of folk that is not country folk, but city folk. Does that make sense?
I think I know what you're trying to say. I would describe it in perhaps more technical terms, which is that I think there's a certain rhythmic engagement with the way the instrument is played, that you have this kind of very consistent, almost unaltering strumming that's going on with the chords.
Uh-huh.
And then layering over that are some chord variations which provide harmonies and harmonics, and then the occasional little riff that's really very Ian, where he throws in that sort of dum 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 and then goes back to it. But there's an interesting parallel there that we've just unearthed, Nick.
The most interesting part is the similarities that I see with my elementary level of music education,
uh-huh,
and yours with more of a mind for music and more of an ear for music, the way that it sounds, the way that it reminds you of Nick Cave versus the way that it reminds me.
Drake.
But we both... No.
Nick.
Oh, it is Nick Drake. The way that it reminds both of us of Nick Drake in different aspects.
Oh, yes.
But it still reminds us of Nick Drake.
It does. And, you know, it's funny. Nick Drake has a lot of songs about London and, you know, being in the city. I don't know where he was born, but there is that sort of feeling of longing, a lot of longing.
So much. So long.
It's long. You know, that perhaps is natural to someone who moves from the country, who loves the country, moves to the city for reasons of employment. Wow, Nick, I feel like we've just in our archaeology, we've tapped at a little rock and opened up a massive, massive volume of space underneath us, and it might be filled with snakes.
Why did it have to be snakes?
Why did it have to be snakes, Nick? Let's...
I personally like snakes, but...
Well... Let's talk about the...
Do you not like snakes?
You know, I respect them. I understand, you know, why evolutionarily they're an effective design for an animal.
A tube.
yeah.
A tube with teeth on one
end. Basically. Yeah. I don't connect with them on an emotional level. Although my fiance is a Slytherin.
She is a Slytherin, isn't she?
Oh, yeah.
What's her sign?
Pisces.
Is there a snake sign? It doesn't matter. Oh, you're both Pisces?
Yes, we're both Pisces.
I don't know what that means, but it can't be good,
fishes.
Right?
It means we're...
Well, I mean, I know that
part. It
means
we're emotional, like, and intuitive and sometimes can be too dreamy or, like, too sensitive.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can do all of that together.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's nice. At least you've got some.
Or in... Yeah. Or at least we can recognize, like, oh, you're feeling emotional and dreamy right now. Cool. I'm going to wash the dishes.
Yeah. You got each other's backs.
Yeah.
Okay. There you go.
Yeah.
Support.
Yeah. Yeah. When she sheds her skin, I've got her back.
To pull the skin off.
I've got the skin off her back, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
Nick, let's talk a little bit about the lyrics for this song, Nursey.
Yeah, the four lines of lyrics.
Yeah, both lyrics. I initially, when I heard the title, I rather presumptuously thought of the brave men and women in the nursing profession.
Uh-huh.
And then as soon as the song started, I was like, what a fool I've been. I was thinking of it in terms of an American perspective on that word, like, hey, Nessie.
An American from the 50s?
I've got a sickness in my pants.
Oh, even worse.
I don't know. You know what I mean. But of course, Ian Anderson.
So like the diminutive of nurse.
Correct.
A nursie. Yeah. Okay.
Which this is. But nurse, in this context, in England or in Scotland, refers to the nurse of a child, meaning a child's caretaker who's not part of the family.
A nanny.
A nanny, we would say here in the States, but...
Yeah. It's the same root as nursery.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you disagree?
No,
or did
I don't.
I just blow your mind?
You blew my mind slightly, yeah. I wonder,
like,
what...
tweak of the mind.
I wonder what the origin of the word nurse is. Hold on a minute.
It's to take care of, but let me get that etymology, baby. If I could type, I'd have it for you by now.
If I could type past time. Hey, okay. Okay. So, do you want to tell me about it, or shall I tell you about it?
I'll tell you what I have, and you tell me if you have anything else. How's that?
Are you going forwards or backwards?
I was going to start at the original.
Okay.
So circa 1200?
Go ahead.
Do you want to do it? You sound disappointed.
No, no, no. Yeah, I'll do it. Okay, so... nurse, we get the modern word nurse from the old English word nurse, which comes from the old English word nourish, from old French nourrice, from late Latin nutricia, from Latin nutriculus.
Nutricius, no L.
Nutricius, person that nourishes, from the Latin nutrix or nutric, nurse, from the original Latin nutrir, or probably nutrire.
Nutrire, yeah. Which means?
To nourish.
Or to suckle.
Oh.
Think about nursing. That's what a nursery was for, was where they would go to feed the baby.
And indeed, in the olden times, you can see this in Romeo and Juliet, the role of the nurse, sometimes called a wet nurse,
yeah,
was literally to nurse the baby.
Yeah, or a dry nurse who didn't nurse the baby.
Or an even drier nurse who...
didn't nurse the baby and did not partake in alcohol.
Right, right. Or a drier.
Or a really wet nurse.
Oh,
who...
dear. Nick, this is a family
fed a baby
podcast.
While in a pool.
And was also a water buffalo. So,
yeah.
So, yes, the term nurse is inherently linked to children and to the caring of children.
Yes.
I don't know what we're thinking over here in the States.
For nanny, you're saying?
No, for nurse in the medical sense. We should just call them little doctors.
Oh,
Lil Docs.
Doctrito.
So then...
A nurse, it grew to be just someone who takes care of someone. It evolved from children specific.
Sure. Or everyone's a child.
I suppose that is an option.
I feel like a child when I'm sick.
Tiptoes in silence round my bed and quiets the raindrops over my head. With her everlasting smile, she stills my fever for a while. Oh, nursey dear, I'm glad you're here to brush away my pain.
And that's why we mistook it for a nurse. Because he talks about having a fever and being in pain, and she takes care of him.
Yeah.
I don't think it's completely out of nowhere. You know, it's not unfounded to think that.
No, but I think it is inherently talking about the fever and raindrops of childhood.
Those childhood raindrops, as we're all aware of.
It's like the opposite. It's the opposite side of the spectrum from Big Bottom Girls.
Fat Bottom Girls?
Fat Bottom Girls. Thank you.
It is still respecting women, but in the complete opposite way.
Well, it's a non-sexualized nurse.
Yeah.
Left alone with Big Fat Fanny. She was such a naughty nanny. Big woman. Made a bad boy out of me.
Now I have to include that song.
Ha ho! That's Queen, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so what about those lyrics? Did you have anything beyond just saying, hey, it's not a nurse, it's a nanny?
I just think it's so lovely. It feels, listening to it, it immediately feels, it produces in me that feeling of childhood and the way that someone cares for you when you're ill, that just, even though they can't make you not ill, they can make you feel so much better. It's that care through love. It's almost talking about, it almost feels like this archetypal healing feminine energy.
Huh. Yeah. Okay.
You know, whether it's the nurse comforting the child or the maiden who revives the knight from his deadly wounds under the apple tree in classical romantic literature. Romance literature.
There is a fondness and such a lovely sweetness to this song, almost a reverence to the reference of the nursey. It's very childlike. He does a fantastic job of making you think that he's an 8-year-old kid tucked in bed, yeah, and the nurse just came in.
Well, and can you imagine, of all the songs that Ian Anderson has written about parental figures, none of them have had this level of affection.
That is a very good note.
And I think it's highly likely that he did, in fact, have a nurse as a child. It was very common during that time, and seems like his family was well enough off to be able to afford one. And, you know, a lot of historical figures say that they were, as children, closer to their nurse than to anyone else.
Sure.
I mean, again, look at Romeo and Juliet. When Juliet has trouble, she doesn't go running off to her mom or, heaven forbid, her dad.
Yeah.
She goes to her nurse.
Her dad's a business tycoon and her mom's an alcoholic.
Yes. All this is true.
I mean, that's how I interpret it. It's Shakespeare. You can kind of get your own thing.
Sure.
So.
Instant Shakespeare. Just add meaning.
Yeah, it's a lovely song.
She must have been a lovely nurse.
She must have been a lovely nurse. And if nothing else, musically, it's just so pretty, so beautiful.
This song, I might have to, if I had had this song a decade or two earlier, it would 100% be in my sleep mix.
Yeah. Wait, is this the first time you've ever heard Nursey?
Yes.
What? Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Wow, because I think Nursey's been included on at least one or two of, like, the multiple compilation albums that they've
had. I've heard nary a note of it.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So that... Yeah, I got not, I'm just, I don't know why I thought you had heard this one before. Okay.
No, it's gorgeous. I think this is automatically gone to a very special place in my heart.
Yeah, his acoustics do that because they're so short and sweet and just, they're distilled and just poignant.
With her everlasting smile, she stills my fever for a while. Oh, Nursey dear, I'm glad you're here to brush away my pain.
Well, Nick.
Yes.
What shall we listen to next week?
Oh, mercy, my sweet Nursey. Omen, next week, we are starting thick as a brick.
That's going to be very interesting, Nick. And for clarification, how are we going to be approaching this album?
So I found a pretty good list of how it's been broken up thematically and sound-wise based on the story being told throughout this album.
Right.
So I have time stamps for each of the tracks. And actually, if you want to check it out, if you want to look ahead, in the show notes of every episode, I have a link to the Google Doc that tells the full schedule for all of Talk Told to Me.
Yeah.
If you want to go check it out,
if you want to plan,
click in there and find the thick as a brick. Plan your vacations accordingly, obviously.
Plan your outfits.
Plan your outfits, coordinate. And you can see that the first episode next week is going to be we're going to call them tracks, even though they're technically not.
Yeah.
The tracks that are Really Don't Mind and See There a Son Is Born. It's basically the first 5 minutes of Thick as a Brick.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, until next week when we dive into that exciting pool of fresh and salty water mixed, you don't have to suffer from your fever because we are here to wipe away your tears. Give us a review.
Don't wait until next week. Take the review that you would write from later and use it now on iTunes with 5 stars, please. And also tell your friends. Find us on Facebook and Instagram at Feckless Moms. And I think that's it. I think that's all we got.
Amazing.
Thanks for sticking around. We just wrapped up Living in the Past.
Yes.
We're going to get into the concept years for the next, oh my gosh, hang on. 3 months.
Woo!
3 months.
Yay.
3 months of concept between Thick as a Brick and Passion Play.
Amazing.
But let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. Thick as a Brick, next week.
Until then.
So excited.
I'm Omen Sade.
And I am Nick McGill.
We are Feckless Moms.
And this is Talk Tull to Me.
Are you a cat who's lost your zest for puking on bed covers?
Does catnip no longer spice up your life?
Are you swishing your tail just because you feel like you should?
When is the last time you knocked a pen off of a table?
Sounds like you need Cat Chat. CatChat.org. Find other cats to chat with, and maybe a human as well.
Cat Chat and Talk Tull to Me are proud members of the Feckless Moms Audio Network.